You are right. Namaste and greetings. I thank the National Film Museum and its director, Dr. Feng, for inviting me here. For someone who is simply a design practitioner, to be addressing such an august gathering of academicians is nothing short of a blasphemy. And I do hope that all of you will forgive my mistakes during the course of this presentation. I come from the Indian city of Varanasi, also known as Banaras. Banaras is where I work with handloom textiles. And as Hangzhou is to China, Varanasi is considered to be the silk weaving capital of India. It is also the cultural as well as political center focus of our country. In the Indian Parliament, Varanasi is represented by none other than Mr. Narendra Modi, our popular Prime Minister. Someone else from Varanasi, almost as famous as Mr. Modi, was the 15th century Indian philosopher Kabir, who was also a weaver. And I would like to start this presentation with a few lines from one of his poems. Jheeni jheeni beeni chadariya, how delicate and pure is this fabric the Lord has woven. Kahe ka tana, kahe ki bharni, kaun taar se beeni chadariya. What is the warp? What weft is this? Of which fiber was made this fabric? Ingla pingla tana bharni, sushman taar se beeni chadariya. The breath taken is the warp. The breath released is the weft. The veins that stretch, the nerves that bind, their flow is this very fabric. Asht kamal dal charkha dole, paanch tatra gun teeni chadariya. An eight petal lotus is the Lord's spinning wheel. It spun the five elements and all three virtues from which this fabric was woven. Sai ko punat maas das lage, ke beeni chadariya. It took the Lord 10 months. It took the finest skill and infinite patience. It took endless labor to beat in this weft. Ye chadar sur nar muni ohi, od od kini maili chadariya. Das kabir yatan se ohi, jo ki vyo thar dini chadariya. Worn by the celestials, worn by the seers and the mortals alike, this fabric was defiled by one and all. Your devotee Kabir wore it scrupulously and discards it just as it was, forever unsoiled, forever pure. So this poem is how God Himself is a weaver who weaves our bodies, the fabric of our bodies, and also that every weaver is a representation of God Himself. This poem was written somewhere around the 16th century, and this is the kind of sanctity which has been given to weaving in India. This poem is also an example of how life and the loom have always been intertwined with each other since centuries in India. This is a demographic slide of India. As you can see in this slide, on the top part, the exceptional demographic diversity of India translates into equally fascinating textile demographics. India is the world's last remaining textile bastion, where handlooms continue to operate at what can be called an industrial scale. According to the Government of India's 2010 handloom census, the total number of handlooms working in India was more than 2 million. In 2014, there were 6 mega clusters having more than 25,000 handlooms each, 20 clusters with 5,000 and 613 clusters having 3 to 500 handlooms each, and several hundred other smaller clusters. These numbers validate a very important point. While hand weaving is now largely confined to artisanal studios elsewhere in the world, in India, the widely dispersed handloom clusters produce not just artisanal, but also commodity textiles of a reasonably high quality for traditional ceremonial usage, casual wear, as well as home furnishings. Just like the language dialects in India, every 100 kilometers, even the handloom traditions have distinguishing features. Now the majority of Indian handloom traditions constitute simple 2 or 4 shaft tabby looms. These also are very diverse in terms of typology, operation, fabric design, as well as the end product. At the other end of the spectrum lie the complex loom that produce India's famed pattern silks. These incorporate not only the well-known jacquard mechanism, but also a variety of traditional draw harness mechanisms, deploying tools and techniques that have largely remained unchanged over the centuries. A number of these weaving techniques are likely indigenous, while many others have been acquired over centuries from various weaving traditions of the world. We'll now start with the loom typology. Many a times, the growth in weaving technologies is not linear, and hence, the classifications here go from the simplest to the most sophisticated of India's traditional looms for commercial production. These do not necessarily reflect the chronological development of the typology. Now, the loin or the backstrap loom is a reedless loom which operates on the body tension of the weaver. These type of looms are prevalent in the northeastern part of India. It was already covered by Dr. Sandra as well, the backstrap loom during her presentation. So it has very similarities to the Indian counterpart. We now come to the reedless vertical looms. The vertical looms which are reedless are mostly used for making cotton coarse daris and floor coverings. The Nawalgarh Jamkhanas from Karnataka are a prime example of this type of loom. The horizontal counterpart of the Jamkhana, it finds more widespread usage in India. Across the northern India, the horizontal ground looms produce commercial floor coverings in varied sizes and large quantities. In both vertical as well as horizontal looms, the patterning is done using the dovetailed and the slit tapestry. The beading is done by a metal fork, which is locally called panja. Hence, these floor coverings are also famously known as panja daris. Somewhere between the body tension loom and the horizontal ground loom sits the frameless patola loom. This is used for double ekar sari weaving in Gujarat. It is again a reedless loom with a differentiating characteristic of being aligned at an acute angle. You don't really see that very often. It's aligned not vertical or horizontal but at an angle. In absence of a reed, the beating is done by a wooden sword. The simplest and the most prevalent of the Indian looms is the pit loom with treadles. This is used for weaving plain weave handspun cotton, which is locally known as khadi. And this is, we mostly see these kind of looms in Bengal or southern India. Now, being a cotton tradition where humidity is beneficial and is required, throw shuttle pit looms were adept at handling finer counts of cotton in the weft, and it can be presumed that this loom type is indigenous. The simplest pit looms are the throw shuttles, but we also see pit looms with fly shuttles regularly in India. Now, with the emergence of the organized cotton industries, especially in the southern India, we invariably come across the counterbalancing fly shuttle frame looms for weaving plain weave cottons. Besides the backstrap loom, the simplicity of operation of this loom is the primary reason why women constitute more than 75% of the total Indian weaver force. Several of the ornamental but non-pattern sari weaving traditions of India, especially those of resist yarn-dyed saris in southern and eastern coastal regions of India, use variations of the simple pit loom or the simple frame loom. Now, as you can see, this is a pit or a frame loom with hand-manipulated jamdani brocading. While we use the term jamdani to identify the fine white-on-white inlay pattern muslin textiles from Dhaka and Tanda in India, the term can also be used to encompass several other Indian supplementary weft inlay textiles, such as Tangali of Gujarat, Chanderi of Madhya Pradesh, and Venkatgiri of southern India. This was almost how all patterning was done in India before the advent of Jaala or Ajkam. In the jamdani technique, the lifting of the warp ends for inlay is done either by memory, as practiced in Dhaka and Tanda, or by using a paper pattern under the warp, known as Uchinna. This is called Uchinna in Varanasi and elsewhere. Now, the supplementary web travels in the same shed as the body web. Hence, it's called Dampach, in the same shed. Even the Paithani tapestry weaving of West India although it is a complementary weft patterning technique, is hand manipulated and is similar to jamdari. The commercial production of jamdari textiles, however, are mostly done on fly shuttle looms. Here, the supplementary weft travels the entire width of the cloth and the floats at the back are shivered, which is called katarma. The next in line of typology is the frame loom for 12 weave wool tapestry. The Kani Pashmina shawls from the Kashmir region of India, they have been amongst India's best known textiles for the past 3 centuries. Especially in Europe, the Kani Pashmina shawl was always considered an object of luxury. The Kani shawls are worked in a fine quill foundation with double interlock tapestry weave. For patterning, and for the patterning, they use long wooden spools, which are called kani instead of bobbins. Now this type of weaving also deploys a numbered lifting sheet, which in the olden days used to be recited as a poem by the master weavers to guide the assistant weavers for lifting. Now a pit loom or a frame loom with bobby, which is used for the bobbins. These looms find widespread use in South India weaver cooperative societies, where the dobby attachment is deployed to weave borders, usually with extra warp of metallic yarn. Most sari weaving traditions of India, like Pochampalli, Mangalgiri, Kerala, they require minimal brocading. Also, many times the body tends to be ikat or yarn dyed, so they don't really require much of brocading happening. So this and that is only in the borders. So the dobby for borders is greatly beneficial for those traditions. Now the pit looms with simple jaala. The cross cord pattern harnessing system is used in several weaving traditions of India. The Himru from Aurangabad, the Alai from Kachipur, the Getua from Varanasi, and the Chanderi, the jaala, they all deploy lifting mechanisms which can be termed as simpler versions of the Varanasi jaala. These, however, are used for less intricate motifs and have several variations to the Varanasi jaala. For example, in Chanderi in Madhya Pradesh of India, the central India, a small pagya or the pattern harness is tied in front of the body shop, not behind. So this makes an easier lifting for smaller motifs by the weaver himself and does not really require a drawer. Now the handmade jacquards, this is the ubiquitous loom in Varanasi right now, the ones with the jacquard. Now the handmade jacquards in the present day are the most widely used patterning mechanism in India. In Varanasi, hand looms with jacquard up to 400 hooks are a common sight and are usually operated by a single weaver. For customized productions, however, jacquards up to 1000 hooks can still be seen being used. The entire process, right from paper pattern designing to graphing to punching and lacing cards, is manually done. There's absolutely no machine involved, not even piano card machine. Everything is manually done. And these jacquard attachments are the primary reason why Varanasi became the pattern web textile weaving center of an industrial scale during the last 20th century. We now come to the last type of loom in India, but the focal point of this presentation, which is the Naksha Jaala loom, the classic Indian draw loom with a cross cord pattern harness as used in Varanasi. The continuance of the Naksha Jaala loom as well as the revival of the Velvet Jaala loom is to a large extent due to the interventions of Mr. Rahul Jain, the foremost Indian textile historian and revivalist. I consider myself very lucky and fortunate to call myself a student of Mr. Jain, who unfortunately couldn't be here today because of previous engagements. Now Mr. Jain, like a very accomplished Chinese Kung Fu master, has taught me many complex handloom weaving techniques. But just like a Kung Fu master would keep the most important, the dim mark, a secret, Mr. Jain has kept the most important of the weaving techniques, which is the Naksha Jaala, very close to his chest. So I seek forgiveness from you all if you find my explanations of the Jaala loom insufficient. Now simply put, Jaala, the term Jaala, translates into a network of threads, which act as the pattern module as well as the pattern harness of the problem. The Jaala tradition in India traces its origins to a 14th century master from Central Asia, Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband. Naqshband means the designer, that is the term, the Persian or the Urdu term for designer. So It's traced to the 14th century Bahau Naqshband of Bukhara. By the 16th century, we come across several references of textiles which are similar to the Iranian Jaala looms being woven at the Mughal workshops in Ahmedabad and Surat in Gujarat. It is from these Mughal karkhanas of Gujarat that the complex Jaala Jaala loom mechanism reached Varanasi in the earlier 18th century. So before 18th century, we don't necessarily have an example of Jaala being produced in Varanasi. The textiles which were being produced were either hand manipulated like Jamdani or they were methods like Getua to produce. The key component of this Jaala loom mechanism is the naksha, a detachable set of vertical drop pods and horizontal pattern harnesses, which acts as a template for the pattern lifting. A design paper is first transferred onto a graph, which is then used as a guide by the nakshaban to make the naksha. The naksha is prepared on a flame called machan, as you can see, a flame called machan, and then this naksha is installed at the upper level of the drawing room. The Varanasi Jaala Jaala loom differs from other traditional Indian looms owing to the presence of a warp beam. Normally, this warp beam is not present in so many other jaala looms in India, and also there is no counterbalance mechanism. The jaala looms tend to normally have a counterbalance mechanism, but in India, there are separate treadles for lifting and depression. One is called paudi, the depression, and the lifting one is called kadi. So there are separate set of treadles for both lifting and depression. Now, in the jaala loom setup, the structure harness consists of a jack-type wooden shafts, while the pattern harness consists of horizontal cross cords, which are called pagia. Now, these pagias hold groups of warp ends with string leashes, which is called naka. The vertical draw cords of the naksha are tied onto the horizontal cross cords of the pagia. To operate the jaala draw loom, the draw boy pulls a single pattern lash of the naksha to separate the draw cords for that particular pattern pick, and pulls these draw cords by inserting and twisting a wooden fork, which is probably called mantra. In the image, you can see a draw boy who is inserting a mantra. Now, these pulled draw cords lift their corresponding cross cords, and thereby the string leashes and the warp ends integrated with them also are lifted, thus creating a pattern shell to pass a pattern test. The weaver then inserts an angled hook called akada. It could be one or two akadas. These are inserted under the draw cords, under the cross cords, to equalize the shed height across the loom, and also the shed to keep the shed open once the draw boy releases the lift. Now, as against the clitter clatter of the jacquard, the jaala weaving is a soundless form of weaving. There is a demonstration of the jaala loom planned on 3rd of June, and Mr. Naseem Ahmed, who is a descendant of Ali Hassan, a very, very famous Indian jaala maker, and himself, Naseem Ahmed ji, is a renowned artisan. He is here to demonstrate a weaving on a jaala loom. These are some images of the products woven on a jaala loom. On the famous Indian gold and silver brocaded textiles, they included fort sashes, saris, and wrappers alongside fabric lengths for stitch garments and furnishing from the 16th to the 19th century. They all owed their magnificence to the exceptional skills of the Indian jaala draw loom weavers operating in the Mughal karkhanas of Western and Northern India, Varanasi, and a few other weaving centers. Here we can see example of a Mughal patta, what is called a sash, a king khab with shikarga and a latifa patta, as well as a floral gyasar brocade. Here you can see images of a dupatta or a stole woven on a jaala loom. All major class of fabrics in Varanasi incorporate the metallic yarn, what we call zari, and for this is the reason that Banaras has been producer of a very high quality of silver metallic yarn with 99% purity. Now, several of Indian brocaded textiles were woven using complex double warp weaving techniques such as lampas, taket, and samit. The second set of warp was used to bind the supplementary web floors, thus resulting in a plain surface even at the back. Now, the complex pine warp velvet technique is the most complex form of weaving, of jaala weaving, which deploys the Jaala mechanism. It had become extinct in Varanasi and has been revived by Mr. Rahul Jain at his Varanasi workshop. Now, along with the usage of complex Jaala mechanism, it has been diminished over time, but it continues to be used owing to its adaptability and versatility. Now, in the image you can see that a Jaala and a jacquard are being used in conjunction. The jacquard is making the entire body make pattern, but the conia, the paisley which you can see, is being made by a Jaala attachment. That was the last slide. These are some of the references which were used during the course of this presentation. Thank you all for bearing with me. I look forward to seeing you at the Jaala presentation on the side.